Well, when you think about AI, today it's mostly like accessing some cloud and some ChatGPT. But when you think about AI everywhere, it's like, okay, you know, I have a neural network in my hearing aid, right, that's helping to process language or, you know, give me cues and hints. You know, we think about the AI PC, where today the PC is still a QWERTY keyboard that was defined in 1884, right? Well, in the future, I'm just going to talk to it. It's going to recognize me, my facial impressions. It's going to translate, contextualize, summarize all the meetings and discussions that I have. It also is going to be the AI edge, right? And I call it the three laws of the edge, the laws of economics. It's cheaper if it's at the edge. They are the laws of physics. I can't round trip to the cloud and back, but maybe most important, the laws of the land. Right, my data needs to stay local and be operated locally. So we see AI permeating the edge, and every supply chain, every supermarket that you go into is going to become AI enabled. Of course, every data center, even though we're about in year 20 of the cloud, almost all the data is still in the enterprise on premise and unutilized. How do we expose the value of that, bringing AI and my existing data resources to full benefit? And of course, AI cloud, where we think about it today. So I truly think about it as AI everywhere, permeating every aspect of our human existence. And much like the internet was, you know, 25 years ago, we see this era of AI bringing AI into every aspect of human existence. And it's a thrilling time to be part of the technology community as a result. Well, I think this idea that, you know, boy, how do I mine my data? You know, as they have, we have all of this data going on, and we have our ERP systems, our customer support systems, et cetera. Almost all of that data is unutilized today. And for instance, we just started to show how we're using AI in our factories, you know, to do predictive maintenance, to be able to do yield enhancements, et cetera, to make our factories the most automated factories, you know, the most cost-effective factories on the planet. Every business has that same kind of problem. You know, what is their resources that can be better monetized in the future? And as you talk to customers, this promise of AI versus where their business practices are today, that's a huge value unlock. And I've recently said, you know, imagine the business in the future where one person is running a $1 billion business. And I think with the age of AI agents acting and participating together, you know, that future is in front of us. I think everybody had a bit of a wake-up call through COVID. It's like, you know, chips, you know, we're not talking about potato chips. We're talking about computer chips. And all of a sudden we realize that everything is going digital. Everything digital uses semiconductors. And the supply chains for those semiconductors, you know, today they become very precarious, right? Mostly in Asia. And all of a sudden we realize that we need resilient, globally balanced supply chains that are trusted, you know, across our economy and across our national security, and sustainable as well. And as we would say, trusted, resilient supply chains, that's what we're out to build. That's why we're quite excited about the CHIPS Act and that coming into play. We've just announced our grants from the Department of Commerce around chips, but also our work to rebuild technology leadership and best products and best capabilities as we become the supplier of many of those technologies for the digital future of everybody. Your healthcare, your finances, your social network, everything is becoming more digital. Everybody is going to be using more semiconductors. And as I like to say, geopolitics has been defined by where the oil reserves have been for the last five decades. The next five decades, the technology supply chains, more important. Let's build them where we want them for our economic and national security interests of the future.